welcome you to the second in this term series on populism and science. And can I start just by explaining a little about the Oxford Martin School to those of you who don't know the school. It was founded in 2005 by the scientist and philanthropist James Martin, who had this idea that research and education would lead to a better 21st century. And through his very generous donation, there are some 35 research institutes, very multidisciplinary, across the University of Oxford, attached here to the school. I represent the Institute of Population Aging, and it's very exciting for us because we actually are celebrating our 20th anniversary. So that's 20 years of population aging research here at Oxford. So we were founded in 1998, and we joined the school when it started in 2005. And we are delighted for the support that the school has given us, and particularly for the opportunity to hold this joint seminar. Now, I can see many familiar faces, and I know last week we talked about the fact that this is a seminar series that we hope many people will come to each of them, because the idea is really to look at this concept of how are we a scientist or a researcher in an increasing populist world. And one of the things I spoke a little bit about last week in the introduction was the idea that populism has actually moved, very sadly, away from seeing some kind of political elite that the public has to be supported against by the populists. And now, in actual fact, all elites are under that same umbrella. So science, culture, the arts, and the media have all been brought into this idea of populism and the public against some kind of elite. And to be able to sort of deconstruct that and what that means for science, I think, is very important. And the other thing we talked a little bit about at the beginning last week was the idea that it's very clear that it isn't just fake news, but it's also unrealistic promises are being made. And sadly, we're seeing them also made either in support of or against scientific evidence by those who aren't really scientists or researchers. So last week we had Andrea Sidomenko, who is from the policy lab of the Cabinet Office, and we talked about the shift from the provider of policy to trying to understand the needs of the consumer. And one of the things I gave as an example was the recent breast cancer so-called scare, where it was declared that some 270 women might have died because they missed that last year of scanning. And we talked a little bit at that time about why it was that the Department of Health had decided to present the material in such a way. But the example we also gave was, how does then the press deal with this? And we're absolutely thrilled that in our second series, our second of the series, we have Fiona Fox, who is the founding director or CEO of the Science Media Centre. And if anyone knows anything about how to get good scientific evidence into the press, it is Fiona. And before she starts, I just want to introduce her. Fiona has a degree in journalism and has worked in media for many years. She worked for the Equal Opportunities Committee, the National Council for One Parent's Families, and she also worked for CAFOD, which is one of the leading aid agency. And I believe you are the founding chief executive of the Science Media Centre, which you founded in 2002. And I think she will fill us in a little bit about some of the ideas about why she felt that this was needed. So before I introduce or welcome Fiona to the stage, can I remind you that this is being filmed? It is also, I think, being streamed. Not so much about the talk, but we're going to have questions afterwards, and hopefully we can have the kind of lively debate we had last week. And you will be filmed and you will be streamed. So if you don't want to be filmed and streamed, can I ask you not to ask a question afterwards, because we won't be able to edit you out. But hopefully you'll be happy to take part in that debate. So can we welcome Fiona to give the second in our series, Where Science Meets the Headlines.
Thank you very much for inviting me, Sarah. I'm delighted to be here, and thank you all for coming along. So as Sarah said, let me just give you a little bit of history about the centre. So we were set up in 2002 when the scientific community just felt that things were not going well. So we had the MMR and autism, you remember Andrew Wakefield, the introduction of GM crops into the wider British public was with horrible headlines like Frankenstein Foods Kill, or the one I liked, which was You Will Find Genes in Your Tomatoes. The BSE, the kind of legacy of that, and animal rights extremists. I mean, those, you all look very young in this audience, but the whole attempt to set up a lab in the middle of Oxford and then the Cambridge. So animal rights extremists were absolutely dominating the debate about animal research. So I would love to say that I couldn't show you such headlines today because of our wonderful success. Of course I could. Sarah just mentioned screening, Charlie Gard, Alfie Evans, cladding today, the big inquiry on cladding. So we haven't changed the headlines, but these were the kind of stories making the headlines then. And the idea to set us up came from David Sainsbury and Susan Greenfield and others, and we just wanted to not have these debates ever again in the media without at least hearing from the experts. So the plant scientists at Oxford, at the John Innes Centre, at Rothamsted Research, for them not to have taken part in that debate, which they really didn't in kind of 99, 2000, it was dominated by Greenpeace and Friends of the Earth and the Daily Mail and columnists, and actually people like Susan Greenfield and Robert Winston waded in to defend science, but the plant scientists who were developing GM really didn't take part. They were bewildered, they hadn't done it before. With a few honourable exceptions, they kind of ran the other way. So we want to make it easier for journalists, and through journalists, the wider public, to get access during these major debates to scientists, to people whose approach to these subjects is to test the hypothesis, is to look for the evidence, is to work on something for 3 years before they publish. So something, people who bring a different approach to some of these big questions. We're not to close down these debates or say that scientists, which some of my colleagues in science do say it, the only people who should speak on vaccines are vaccine experts. That's patently not true. But to have a debate about vaccines and not hear from medics who work on vaccines or the scientists who develop them, I think is not good for any of us. So that is the kind of VMV of the Science Media Centre. Everybody's first question is, well, who funds you then? Especially journalists who are always very cynical, follow the money, is this some kind of big pharma? It's not, it's got the most bonkers funding scheme you've ever seen, but actually beautiful for what we're doing. So we are funded by over 100 organisations, but they all give us small amounts. Thank you very much to Stephen, who's in the audience, from Oxford University Press Office. Oxford do fund us, thanks to Stephen. But we get funding, small amounts, from lots of universities, from, yes, science-based companies, from the media. We used to have 5 media sponsors, and we have one left, the Daily Mail. Who does that exclude? And some government departments, Bays, etc. So lots of people, but giving us about £5,000-£10,000. If any of you come up to me afterwards and offer me £25,000, I'd have to refuse because there's an upper limit. So we don't take more than 5% of our running costs to avoid that undue influence. So this is a slide I start with really because I'm a Luddite and I think people get too obsessed with social media. I encourage you all to use social media. I encourage you all to tweet. I encourage you all to start writing yourselves and do a blog and speak at science festivals. But please don't ignore the national news media. It's still a huge beast. It might, you know, newspapers, print, as in the old fashioned media, might not be selling, but news online, on BBC Online, on all of those papers' websites, is being read by millions of people around the country. And it often sets the agenda for social media. So please don't say, I don't want to speak to the Daily Mail, but I do tweet, because probably, no disrespect to any of you, but you're probably being followed by people on Twitter who are already interested in science and already like you've all heard of the bubbles, I'm sure. So we want to really encourage scientists to engage with the national news media as well as talking directly to scientists and people interested in science. I have some good news for you. So I'll start with some good news. This is the latest Who Do We Trust poll. Scientists are still doing, battle with scientists who say, what's the point in me going on the media? People, and especially post-Trump actually, and fake news, there's a real kind of despair about, nobody will believe me, no one trusts us, and actually scientists always do very well, and their trust ratings have actually gone up in the latest poll. And you will have noticed, always the same, right at the bottom, politicians, right at the bottom, journalists. So you are right up there, and that is an opportunity So we would really urge you that people, for whatever reason, do trust doctors and scientists, so you will get hearing. So really, the rest of the talk is about our philosophy and ways, kind of techniques, approaches, for you to get in on this debate. Like I say, a lot of people just think it's impossible to get in on it. No one will listen. The media won't want to hear from a crusty academic. But there are ways of doing it, and I'm going to show you some examples. There are hundreds more because I won't have time to show them. But the philosophy is this. If you decide you want to do it, you can get media trained, you can get the support of your university press officers, you can engage. There are lots of people out there to support you. And if you engage, you will make a difference. That's really my message. I've seen it. We've been open now for 16 years. I've seen it time and time again on subjects where people were in despair with the way the media was covering them. You can change what the public's seeing here. So how do we do that? Inject some of this fantastic science and evidence that you're all working on into every aspect. So look at the ways that the news media cover science, find out how they do it, not our idealized view of how they should do it, but what they actually do, and really find those kind of points of entry for science. And see science in the headlines as an opportunity as well as a threat. You know, I always remember Fukushima, when a learned society who specialised in radiation wouldn't give us any of their experts on the basis that we're waiting for, getting ready for Radiation Week, which was in November in Fukushima. And I was saying, oh my God, you know, the entire British public are learning about radiation because it is in the headlines every day. Fergus Walsh is explaining a millisievert on television and saying how much you're exposed to on an aeroplane as opposed to if you're in Tokyo. You know, these are fantastic opportunities when everybody cares. You know, I'm sure there have people been debating breast screening. In fact, I know they've been debating massive rounds about breast screening, but the public didn't know about these debates. And then suddenly there was a week where everybody was reading about screening. And so they're an opportunity as well as a threat. So the rest of the talk is really just examples. And as I say, we are a very productive press team. Please go on our website and have a look at the other examples. But what we do is we run rapid reaction to breaking stories, roundups, which I'll explain, which put research into context, and we run press briefings. So this I've kind of already said, and this is what a rapid reaction would look like. So Charlie Gard, obviously my colleagues have probably got a slide set now for Alfie Evans as well. So these are huge, huge stories. You know, before many scientists or clinicians had spoken, Trump had spoken, the Pope had spoken, and finally Theresa May was forced to speak. And that's the thing about these big stories, is because they're on every front page, these leaders are being asked, what is your view on the Charlie Gard situation? And very rarely do they say, I don't think it's my place to say. We might all like them to. These are real stories for all these reasons. Dying child, desperate parents, race against the clock, story developing day by day. So we often get questions from the journalists and send them out to the scientists who've agreed to speak, and they can change three or four times a day. Now my editor wants to know this. Do your experts know that? And most importantly, conflict. I know that's, you probably all hate that, but it's true. If there's jeopardy, if there's a row, if there are two sides, then the media absolutely love it. Difficult questions, but important questions, and questions that the public have every right to ask, and reporters act on behalf of the public. So just in terms of the mechanics, what do? We have a database of 3,000 very, very, very good scientists. If you are not on it in this room, social scientists as well, we really would love to recruit you. So you get on the database, we put your keywords, which are the kinds of stories that we could come to you on, and you will get an email into your inbox the minute the story breaks. Are you available? Have you got anything to say? If you haven't, then please don't. But is this something that you do know about? If you don't, does the scientist in the room next door know? Could you get her to phone us or whatever? So just really kind of reaching out to people and saying, you're on our database. Please tell us what you're thinking about this. So we get those very, very quickly, and we proactively, there's nothing reactive. Obviously, we're reacting to breaking news, but we don't sit there and wait for the phone to ring and see what journalists are. We ask the journalists straight away, what are you asking? What do you need? What are your editors asking? And then we proactively send these comments out, and we'll send a note saying, this scientist is available now for 3 hours at an airport, can speak to you on the phone, but not in a studio, whereas this other expert could actually come into Sky News for a couple of hours and do back-to-backs. So you're making it very, very easy. You know, you're making it just as easy
for journalists to get somebody who knows what they're talking about and is a real expert, as it is for them to get the politician who wants in on this, or the single issue campaign group who want in on this. So I'm sure, I know this is PowerPoint crime, it's just to give you a little bit of an idea. You know, I don't think, you know, we're not actually into kind of media trained, spun comments, messages. I hate the word messages. I don't recognise that in science. We are looking for comments from your expertise. Obviously, they have to be accessible in plain English, but these aren't sound bites. These are not sound bites or killer quotes that you want journalists. They are your comments on your area of expertise. And you would be amazed, every journalist values these. They may not quote them, may not copy and paste them, but they may just read through them. Very often, you'll find that people like David Shukman, the science editor of the BBC, or Fergus, or it's Tom Clark now on ITN, they are on themselves, so the presenter of the 10 o'clock has got them on and saying, can you tell us what the experts are saying about this? So they will have read all these, and that will be informing how the medical research community is responding. And then journalists do, I mean, we have a kind of crisis in journalism where we have ever fewer journalists filling ever greater space. I mean, literally, that is the dynamic. They are very time poor. They used to write one article a day for tomorrow's print telegraph of 800 words, and now they're writing three or four stories a day of 2,000 words for today's Telegraph Online. So the nature of journalism has changed. They've never needed us to engage more, and they, you know, quite often will include three, four, five quotes, fact boxes that we send them. So again, this is an opportunity. So they'll copy and paste the quotes, and those quotes, therefore, all it means, it's very basic, all it means is when you're reading the media coverage of these stories, within that you will read from people who understand these issues. This one, actually, and we can maybe talk about that in the Q&A, we really struggled on Charlie Gard and Alfie Evans. As you might imagine, these are really difficult stories, but we, in fact, if you're interested, my colleague has written a blog on it. We were very critical of a lot of the NHS Trust CEOs and directors of comms who just closed down everything, told all of their staff not to talk, which we totally understand if you're the hospital at the middle of the storm, but other hospitals around the country. So Great Ormond Street were told not to speak in the Alderhay case. And you know, I can see all the good reasons for that, but I can see a lot of bad reasons as well, because it means that the people who are expert, who really know what kinds of things go on, are not available. And I think you really saw in both of these cases how the kind of family's concern dominated the media, and that those people who actually work on a day-to-day basis with children in this condition weren't being heard. So another quick example of a rapid reaction. This one is quite a long time ago, but the reason I love it is because most of the scientists who gave us a comment on this particular story had been the ones I'd met in 2002 and had told me, Ottilien Leiser, I'm sure you know some of these, had actually told me, we didn't engage Fiona because it was all too horrible, and we were invited on Five Live to a chat show with Greenpeace and just didn't want to do it. And we had actually spent a lot, not just us, university press officers, funders, you know, we were very much a product of a changing culture. But yeah, these scientists now, from 2002 to 2008, had completely changed their own attitude. So I have to say, I had nothing to do with that. I was sitting on a beach in Greece and saw somebody reading the Daily Telegraph and thought, oh my God, what's Prince Charles talking about? So apparently it was a Telegraph exclusive, but it ran all of that day. And he was saying GM is responsible for climate change and for all environmental degradation. GM is the cause. So we went to all of these. I mean, you can see the quotes, they'll be online somewhere, but this kind of group of academic plant scientists who hadn't engaged in the frenzy of 2000, but who did engage and were extremely strident. And the reason I like this particular example is that all of the coverage the next day, so the Telegraph had its exclusive, it ran on the kind of broadcast, all of the newspaper coverage the next day, the headlines went to the scientists. It completely transformed the story. So Prince Charles accused by scientists of abusing his position. Scientists condemn Prince Charles' attack. This Guardian one really made me laugh, because we issued six quotes, and the article was the six quotes, with a sentence on the top and a sentence on the bottom. So, and that's a great picture of Prince Charles and a great headline. So you can change what the public see and hear, but only when you engage. That none of that would have happened. It would have gone on for days. So the roundups are slightly different. If you think of what goes wrong, things go wrong when a media story is a frenzy, for all the reasons I said. The Pope gets involved, Trump gets involved. But the other way in which I think journalists fail the public is with the new studies. I'm sure Ben Goldacre and others who care about this subject talk about this a lot. The one-off study that, to probably most people in this room, one-off study done in mice contradicts 10 previous studies that were bigger, done in humans, done in randomized control trials, but it shows that e-cigs are dangerous, statins kill you, what else, HRT kills you. But it's a one-off study. So for scientists, it's a jog on, isn't it? Well, we're not interested in that because it's small and preliminary. But for the journalist, it's treated exactly the same as those big randomized controlled trials in humans, because it's in a journal, it's been press released, and it's new. The clue is in the title. They're news journalists, and this is new science. Just been published today, the embargo just lifted, so it's new for all of you, and any of you can take it, and believe me, they do. So five or six of the stories that you read every single week are just from the big journals, so the BMJ, the Lancet, JAMA, Nature, Science, PLOS, so, and not even those. I mean, there are thousands of journals. Certainly the journalists don't scour every journal looking for a story. They run the stories from the journals with media operations so that they get a press release into their box. So we have privileged access to these. We get these press releases before the embargo is lifted. That gives us 2, 3, 4 sometimes days notice. You all could tell probably, you know, red wine causes cancer, red wine cures cancer. The Daily Mail is going to love this. So you identify the stories, or maybe it's been taught. If there's a story about screening tomorrow, we would absolutely know the journalist would go for that. So we'll identify the ones that we think are going to make a splash, and we go back to that database that you're all going to be on as of tonight, and seek third-party comments. Now, this is like a little... please don't tell us what the paper says. The press release will do that, and they're good press releases. But give us that context. Give us that crucial thing. This is a beautiful study from my colleagues in Oxford, but it's only done in mice. It's a very small study, and it contradicts the previous 10 studies. So it should be treated with caution. Or the exact opposite. You know, a lot of the journalists love it because we might send 7 quotes from 7 scientists, no conferring, different universities, all saying, this is the Holy Grail. This happens a lot on stem cells. I cannot get my head around what is new and what isn't. I think I've seen everything before. Then I send it to the scientists and they say, oh, we've done this before, we've done this before. And then one comes and they say, this is it. This is what everyone in Europe has been trying to do. And this group in Oxford have done it. So these little comments are to basically say to the journalist, should you cover this at all? If you do cover it, should it be on the front page or should it be on page 8 with the comments from our people, our scientists, somewhere in the middle of the article saying this should be treated with caution? So basic minimum, you get more measured and accurate coverage. So this was what, I mean, don't even start me on where some of these stories come from. I think in it here, I was just looking at it again. At an event held at a Cumberland hotel. Because that, ladies and gentlemen, is where all the scientific breakthroughs are made. At events booked in a Cumberland hotel. So this was extremely suspicious. Plus, extraordinary claims need extraordinary evidence. Cow's milk leads to autism. Effectively, this is what they were saying. So we then take that. I think on that occasion, one of the journalists tipped us off, which is great, and increasingly they will tell us. We then go out, and you can see, I mean, all these quotes are basically saying, this is ridiculous. Hasn't been peer-reviewed, I think a couple of them said. Impossible to look at the data, we can't even assess it. So that is not unusual. That is really not unusual in our office to have 7 or 8 people knocking down a story. Coverage? 0, I'm delighted to say. So we don't get that all the time, but it worked. And these are the journalists, you know, I'd like to pay some homage to our journalists, our science and health journalists in particular, that we are very lucky to have them. In other countries where we have SMCs, they've lost their specialists. So Australia, New Zealand, in the States, the first people to go when there are cuts in the newsroom are the science and health. For some reason that I've never quite worked out, we haven't lost. And I think it could even be MMR, that the editors felt like they'd got it wrong and were a bit bruised. They don't like to get it wrong on the whole. So we've got specialists and they do care, and they're the ones very often who say, oh my God, you know, my news editor wants to splash on this, get me some comments to help me knock it down. So, as I said, it doesn't always do that. Now, this is different because this was in Nature and it's John Collins, I'm sure some of you know, very good scientist. But when we saw the paper, we thought, oh my God, this is effectively saying that you can catch Alzheimer's. Now, it's from surgical equipment, a small group of people. The people hadn't developed Alzheimer's because they died of CJD. So there was lots of caveats. But we all know what a good self-respecting news editor does with something like this. If they can say it, they will. So, like I said, good study, published in Nature, but lots of limitations. So we went back out to that database. Sorry for the PowerPoint crime, but you can look at all of these on our website later, but you get the point. You know, taking it seriously, saying that this was good study, but just getting, you know, absolutely explicit that if you put Alzheimer's is catching, that will be the wrong headline. So, exactly the headline, I think almost every paper. But I would like to say this did work because it lasted one day. It lasted only one day. And some of the MMR debacle, the statins debacle, there are others that last for months and months and months. And you really, you know, doctors tell us that people ask to come off statins because they've read about 20% of people have severe side effects. That fact is not true. It's inaccurate. It's 1% of people. But people are asking to come off because they read it in the paper. So this stuff matters. And the fact that it was a one-day wonder, and importantly, what I'm showing you here, which it was balanced. So I don't know. We you know, what we should do is pay for someone to do research about how the public read these papers and whether they do look at that. Oh, the Alzheimer's Society head of research said we shouldn't be too worried, so we won't be too worried. I don't know, but you know, if you've got a choice between those quotes being there or not being there, I think you would want them to be there. So yeah, lots of quotes were used. And it was a nice story of press officers as well. This involved John Collins's press officers at UCL, Nature press officers, the Science Media Centre press officers, and one other who I can't remember, who would have been the fourth one? Oh, the MRC, because it was funded by the MRC. Four really good press officers sitting down weeks before the paper was published to work out how to manage this. Right, final slide set. Press briefings. When I was when I was appointed, I said, why doesn't the SMC start to do some physical press briefings, like background briefings, so get a topical issue, four or five amazing scientists in one room. And people absolutely scoffed at me and said, you are so old-fashioned, Fiona. No one goes to press conferences anymore, no one holds them anymore, they sit at their desk and they write articles. We now average 60 press conferences a year. And our average attendance is 10 journalists. And we don't allow bloggers or magazines or, you know, Pharma, Online, Weekly. They're all national news journalists, the majority. We let Nature in, a new scientist. So we do these briefs. And because, again, we're lucky we're in London, so we're half an hour away from everybody's newsroom. So this was one that I thought I would show you. Please, like I say, do take a look at the website to see the kind of range of issues we cover. But this one was, I don't know if any of you remember this, I think it's probably 2 or 3 years ago now, but yes, there was this, it was a study, and actually it was later retracted, with this 20%. So 20% of people taking statins are having severe side effects. And then a group of campaigning activists kind of leapt on this and used it to promote their arguments against over-medicalization. And I think the debate over over-medicalization is absolutely fascinating. But statins were used inaccurately to say this is over-medicalization. People who could just lose a bit of weight and exercise are, you know, previously healthy people or put on drugs for the rest of their life. And that's fine to have that debate. That's an important debate. But in doing so, they misled the public. And that's really very dangerous. So we had a phone call from Fergus Walsh and a couple of other people just saying, do you know what, Fiona, right now, I don't know how to report this story. Different papers, kind of small observational studies showing bad news. The big, I'm sure some of you know Rory Collins from the CTSU here in Oxford. Massive, multi-centre, huge numbers of people, very robust trials, saying that the side effects are relatively low, less than 1%. So conflicting information, but lots of people call doctors. you know, GPs were speaking out against statins. They hadn't researched them, they hadn't got any new data, but they didn't like putting people on statins. So for the science journalists, this was, you know, the 20% claim was published in a top medical journal. It was later retracted because that fact was inaccurate. But how is a news desk meant to know if it's published in a top journal? So what do you do in this situation? What I would say is what you don't do is do nothing. Don't do nothing, because you can have an impact. And that is my real message to scientists, is we've been doing this for 17 years on the most messy, politicized, controversial science subjects, and we make a difference, a positive difference. Journalists come to this, these were like the top, we were looking for the scientists who'd actually done the studies. That's what we set out. We didn't want people with lots of opinions or pro-statin, anything like that. We said, where have the studies been? Who did the Cochrane? What's his name here? George Davy Smith. He did the big Cochrane. Right, let's get him in. Who did the big RCTs? Rory Collins. Peter Weisberg, head of director of research at BHF. So we got them in. I present you, you know, no new story, no new findings, no new journal paper. Nothing, just four or five people sat on a boring table in the Wellcome Collection where we live, and all of these journalists came. So it was a fantastic turnout, and guess what? The media reported what they said, which was really important. And at the very least then, no doubt the week after, there were headlines saying statins are dangerous. But still, it's better to have at least both of those, and hopefully people will go off and find for themselves. So that's that. We do lots of briefings. We do science policy briefings, new studies where new studies, but the ones where the authors come to us and say, I'm actually scared this is going to be overhyped, and I want to look into the whites of their eyes in that room and say, do not say this means blah. So they're the kind of studies we do. And then gene drives, obviously very controversial at the moment, human genome editing, etc. So that's it. Take home messages. Can't complain if you don't engage, and honestly, engaging does change what the public see and hear. Thank you.
Thank you very much. What an enlightening talk. Anyone who didn't quite know how it all worked, I think now absolutely knows. So thank you very much. We agreed that this was such an interesting topic that we would leave quite a lot of time for questions. So we can now open it up and please do, we have some microphones. So if you just put your hand up, then we can bring a microphone. Yes, first one.
Just to get things going, Miles Allen, University of Oxford. I couldn't help noticing that you didn't mention climate change once. Is that because, is that because that's our greatest failure in science communication?
No, I'm kicking myself, given that you're the first question. No, I tend to work on medical research stories. As you know, Tom Sheldon, my colleague, I don't think it is our biggest failure. I think you probably know what I think, which is that we've done incredibly well on climate change. I think that apart from a couple of newspapers with editorial lines against, most of the newspapers cover climate change quite well. Most politicians now subscribe to climate change, most business people, most of the public. If you looked at the different attitudes, public attitudes on things like nuclear, nuclear is awful. It's still right down there. You know, the public just don't trust the nuclear industry. If you look on climate change, the Nick Pidgeon research, you're up to 60, 70, 80, depending on which question you ask. So, you know, I argue with Bob Ward about this because Bob is a kind of big climate press officer, and he really always sees the kind of the negatives, and I just think we're doing really well. I think it's really positive. I mean, there are battles, and if one thing that's a real battle is how do you keep climate change in the papers, which is not actually the Science Media Centre's job, but if I was a press officer working at the Grantham Institute, that would be my concern, is that we've run briefings recently with poor turnout, not very much coverage, with the exception of your briefing, Miles, which was very well covered and very prominent.
But just to follow that up then, you mentioned sort of editors regretting early coverage of MMR and feeling they got it wrong. But can you think of an editor who thinks they got it wrong on climate change?
Do you mean the editors who have got it wrong, in our view.
Well, I mean, either way, I don't know. It's not for me to say who's right or wrong here, is it? Yeah. But the point is that I don't see a change of editorial line.
No, I think that's true. And I might be wrong about MMR. I just think there is something very interesting as to why the UK, which has all of the same economic factors as these other countries where they've sat. I mean, CNN sacked 8 people in their science unit overnight, and they now have general news reporters who report their science stories. And we just haven't seen that here. So it's real speculation. And there were people who told, Jonathan Leake from the Sunday Times told me that after MMR, the editor wrote a note to everybody on the staff and said, in future, all science stories must be run past the science editor. So that's what, plus it's difficult, isn't it? Because where there's still a massive debate, then those editors who've got a climate skeptic policy will still say they're right. It's easier to say on MMR, the data is in, the facts are in, and we know that vaccine doesn't cause autism, in a way that some people would still contest that we've got the facts in and the debate is closed. But you know, I would hope that if you had editors up here, and I encourage you to invite some of them, that they would say they thought about their climate coverage. I mean, look at The Guardian, Alan Rusbridge's last campaign. He was leaving The Guardian after 20-odd years. He could have decided to have his legacy campaign on many, many issues. He decided to have it on climate change. And actually, controversially, partly because I don't know if you ever read, Miles, the Fireside Chat. Did you ever read that? So it was Alan Rusbridge writing about why he decided that Keep It In The Ground would be The Guardian's last campaign on his watch. And he described it as a failure of journalism that propelled him to do that, that all this great Guardian journalism on climate change hadn't delivered zero emissions, hadn't achieved the goal, so he had to ramp it up. And I can tell you that some journalists were rather disappointed that was his conclusion, that all their wonderful journalism hadn't made a huge difference. And I'm with those journalists, I think it already had.
Can I ask you to talk a little bit about GM crops? Because I know if you talk to the Go Science group, the government office of science group, the one thing that they talk about is also GM and how everybody got it so wrong. And so the idea was that they were going to announce this policy, that they would just come out with the policy and the public would actually accept it. And then they realised how badly they'd got it wrong. And it's obviously something that you as a journalist also faced. So just, if you can just talk me through exactly, I mean, why did people think they could just literally come in with something like GM, say to the public, well, this is what we're going to do, and were surprised when there was such a kickback at that time?
I don't know. I don't know the answer. To speculate, I think when we started, it felt a little bit like the age of deference dying had suddenly hit the ivory towers. Mm. So we'd stop believing in the church, we'd stop trusting politicians, we'd stop trusting all of these different, our trade union, all the old things that we used to look to, the media, you know, getting your line from the Mirror or the Mail or whatever. But there was still, certainly, the scientists that I met still felt that they could sit in the ivory tower, work on the study for 4 years, come out for one day, publish it, do 5 interviews, preferably not with the Mail, just Today programme, and then go back in. So there was no kind of concept of public engagement. Now, why the government thought that was a good way, I do not know. Mm. One thing I can tell you is that if you read Alistair Campbell's first diaries, I think he's on version 7 now, there's a hilarious bit in it where Tony Blair came out very early publicly in support of GM crops. And then, if you see those diaries, they are literally kind of verbatim. So he walks in one morning and says, Tony, mate, Tony, stop going on about GM crops. The public aren't with us. Stop talking about it. And Tony said, well, I think we should. I believe in them. And Alistair said, no, don't worry. The scientists will do it. And I always wondered, did anyone think, who's going to tell the scientists? Government are now going to withdraw and not say anything. It's their job to do it. Because again, those scientists that I met are John Innes and Roth Hampstead, and they certainly didn't feel a sense of responsibility. And to be fair to them, they, you know, GM, I think in particular, medical research is sexy. That's why I work on it in the SMC, because I was there first, so I grab it. Plant science really struggles for its It's front page coverage. So these plant scientists would, you know, they'd have had a lovely, fantastic breakthroughs on the front page of Nature about plant genetics, beautiful pictures. Nobody covered it. So they really were bewildered. Mm. So, I mean, I don't know the answer to GM. What I do know is that that approach is not one that the SMC endorse at all. We embrace debate. We don't say how can we, and I go to some of these meetings where they say the lesson from GM is to work out how to stop this debate and stop people opposing nanotechnology in the first place. How do we do that? Or human genome editing. You know, I even sat in a meeting not that long ago where someone was saying the Catholic Church are going to get involved in human genome editing. How do we stop them? And I, you know, I'm born and bred a Catholic, and my poor mum, I still take her to Mass. And I thought, God, what? They're the Catholic Church. Yes, how do we stop them? We don't. And nor should we want to. Nor should we want to. If the Catholic Church wants to have a say on human genome editing, good for them. What the key thing is that in that debate, those scientists who are working on human genome, or mitochondrial DNA, by the way, that was an incredible story. You know, baby with three parents. Mm-hmm. And what a lovely story of where the scientists, and I know, what was his name? Not Bruce, I've forgotten his name now. Doug Turnbull in Newcastle. For the first couple of years, did not want to do media on that. He's just, and if you know him, he's just not a kind of media type at all, but just slowly recognised that he had to get it through Parliament, he had to get public support, enabled to actually offer this treatment. He's a doctor that treated these babies like Charlie Gard with mitochondrial disease that die at the age of two, a painful death. So he wanted to offer this treatment, but he worked out that to do that, you need to engage the public and you need to speak to journalists. But what he never said was, right, I want to go out there, tell this story without anyone asking me a question, without any opposition, and without having to debate these issues.
Yes. We have a question.
Yeah, I have two related questions. The first is, in this country, because the BBC occupies such a unique position in the media market and it has a public service mission, do you find that they're more amenable to your cause, to your mission, than other papers that might have a more political or ideological agenda? That's question one. Question two is, looking at your, I did note that half of the journalists at that last press conference came from the BBC. That was what got me thinking about it. I'm also wondering, if journalists rank so low, just above politicians in terms of trust, why do you believe or hope that the public will trust what they'll say, you know, even if you give them good facts, quote unquote?
Yeah, very, very good questions. So, number one, yes, and I suppose that's, I mean, that's actually written into their charter, you know, the Reithian, entertain, educate and inform. And yes, we find that, you know, this objectivity, neutrality. There are rows about it in the BBC and on overseas issues and Yugoslavia and all of that. There were big rows that you should be neutral in the face of genocide and stuff like that. But on the whole, certainly in science, it is the bottom line. So you could easily write to a BBC editor and say that programme, that panorama, and I have said it on Panorama, was totally biased from start to finish and was not what the BBC should be doing. I mean, it's certainly fine to have one, to put forward one side, but to have a reporter who's selective and biased. So yes, you're right. The BBC, it's easier to say to the BBC, you have a responsibility to get this right in a way that other people don't. I mean, you know, you can occasionally, it depends which journalist you talk to. You can say to a journalist, you got this wrong and you misled the public. And they smile and say, and we should care about that. Why? And they just don't see it as part of their role. Their role. In fact, we were talking about this recently at the Friday debate that Rory arranged about journalists being emphatic that their job is to report what is said accurately, but not to get to the truth. Do you see the distinction there? So the maverick scientist who says MMR causes autism, if he says MMR causes autism, you have just reported it accurately. But getting to the truth is not their job. So, and I would say, also, I would say there is a kind of, you could say, people would say, there's a fine tradition of politicised campaigning print journalism in the UK. So some people would say it's not all bad. You know, the Independent ran their pro-cannabis campaign under Rosie What's-Her-Name for years, and the Daily Mail, actually, when they do decide to campaign, like on Windrush,
they're very effective campaigning journalists. They don't for a second, the thing that I was just talking to Miles about the Keep It In The Ground campaign that The Guardian ran about fossil fuels, it was not neutral and objective. So newspapers have more of a license. But I do want to say to you, because I think this is really misunderstood, given that we're all about accuracy, that's what the SMC was set up to do. So we have a different vantage point. You know, other press officers do care about accuracy. Oxford, the team at Oxford are brilliant and, you know, really care. But it isn't their job to improve the accuracy. It will be their job to make sure that your amazing discoveries published in journals get to the journalists. Our job is accuracy, so that's all we care about. And yet we got on very well with these journalists. So something is going right there. They do respond. So I'll give you a very good example. We are about to launch a new labelling system for press releases, which with that thing I was talking about earlier, the small, the non-peer-reviewed, preliminary, it will put labels on the top of every press release, which will tell the journalist at what stage this is at. And you hope that at some way this will influence the way it's reported, and the public then will be better able to judge between a huge trial that is really pretty much telling them this drug is safe or not, and an abstract at a conference where there was no data, and what is it, 85% of abstracts presented at conferences don't even get published. Never mind go on to be a cure, they don't even get published in a journal, but journalists still report abstracts. So we're saying, fine, if you have to report it, fine, we can't stop you, but please let the reader know that that is unpublished research, which will probably never come to anything. So why am I saying that? Because I just want to say again that we would be out of a job and we would be miserable if there wasn't something to appeal to there. Almost all these specialist journalists are trying to get it right, trying to put that article in the right place in the paper, battling with their editors on a daily basis. So there certainly aren't a bunch of people who don't care and only care about entertainment.
We have a whole load of questions lined up. There's a microphone there, and then there's a lady over there second.
Hi, Paul Aveyard from Primary Care. We work on smoking and weight control, and we like to engage on with the public on those issues. But we also work sometimes with certain industries in those areas.
Yes.
And in the media, sometimes it sort of can be a bit of a free
yes.
swing if you do that. Although we don't take personal income, and there are others who other perfectly respectable scientists who have quite a substantial income from private industry connections. I wondered how much you thought that mattered and how you might sort of deal with that when you're in the media area. You know, is that a sort of free hit for just anyone
yeah.
wants to go?
Oh, you know, all these, and I didn't come back to your second one, I will come back later, but all these questions are brilliant, but they all take a whole meeting to answer properly. Briefly, it really, really matters. And I've got a horrible feeling that it matters increasingly, which worries me. So what we're talking about here is, you know, we're all talking about trust, we're all talking about the need for the public to understand where the best quality evidence lies, where the weight, and e-cigs is a classic example, statins, HRT screening, where is the good evidence? So where should you at least look to? What should you rely on? If then a group of campaigners and journalists are walking around saying, well, so Rory Collins's trials are absolute classic. So the CTSU here in Oxford does these big trials, but they are, a bit of them are funded by companies that make statins. The funding goes to the university. There are 20 firewalls between the funding and the individuals. They never see the money directly. There's very little research that doesn't have some kind of industry funding. There is some, but there's increasingly little. And indeed, the research councils are telling you, get out there and get local industry to fund your research. So if a journalist is then saying, you can't rely on these studies because they're funded by the statins industry, but you can rely on this little observational one done in a lab, which says terrible side effects, but it's got no industry money, so it's clean, it's pure, it's reliable. That's really dangerous. And I don't just think it's the journalists, I think the campaigners are very aware of that. And when I was talking earlier about the statins thing, one of the other things that triggered it was NICE extending, so giving statins to more, a higher percentage of healthy people. And that really started in earnest then, that anybody who worked on statins was, they attempted to discredit them because they're funded by the industry. Now, having said that, it's way beyond my pay grade to sort that out, and I wish that science would sort it out. And I've said to people like Mark Walpert, who was the government chief scientific advisor, and others, and I said it to Patrick Vallance when he came in, he's now the chief, make some big speeches or write some articles to explain to the public why scientists working more with chemical companies, pharmaceuticals, why that is a good idea. Because right now, you seem to think it's a brilliant idea, but I don't think you've explained it to the public or journalists, who right at the beginning I said when I showed you our funders, the one group of people who are very suspicious about money are journalists. Where's the money coming from? How can I trust this? So I just really want somebody to sit down with some of these journalists as well and go through this. And let's have guidelines. You know, the ones that take it individually into their bank account, I think that's a stupid, personally, I think that's a really stupid thing to do because they're asking for it. But you know, so have guidelines about what. I was very impressed actually by Oxford when Rory and then Susan Jebb got caught up in all this. The statements issued by, well, A, I was impressed that Oxford University Press Office supported their academics. Because sometimes it feels like the academics who've taken the funding from industry are then hung out to dry a bit, and their funders don't support them, because it's never a nice experience. You know, you've worked for 40 years, built up your credibility, and then somebody says, you did that for money. You found that result in that study because you're getting money from this particular company. That's a horrible smear against your integrity. So I thought it was brilliant when Oxford came out and did an extremely clear, in fact, we actually ended up issuing the quote on the Susan Jebb thing, to just explaining the process by which the money comes into the university, and peer review, and the process of scientific publishing. These things can be completely firewalled, before I even go on to say about other biases. You know, money is not the only thing that's a bias. Yeah, we have people who comment on bees and pesticides who write a book a year about alternatives to pesticides. But they're publishing studies and they're commenting on all in one direction all the time. And sometimes you send them the paper and the comment arrives in your inbox 3 seconds later. And we say, it's really important to us that you read this paper before telling us it's absolutely wonderful because it backs up my point of view. So there are all kinds of biases. And I do think journalists should be mindful of those. I think it's the journalist's job to follow the money and to ask, is this person who's talking to me got a conflict of interest? But we need it, unless the whole of science is not going to be trusted, we need to somehow say what's acceptable funding from industry and what isn't.
We have a load of questions, but
can I just
pick up on what you said about trying to explain to the public that science is funded in a certain way and there is peer review and there is a process to go through. Are people interested in that? Do they get it? Do the journalists communicate it? Does it? So in a way, how do we get the public to understand that science is nuanced and complex? And
okay, so I think that's difficult, yeah. And you're absolutely right. They're not interested. So you're not going to get an article about the funding of science and peer review. What you can do, one of the reasons I love our physical briefings is that the journalists learn that in that room. Mm-hmm. So they've got four scientists, they ask questions, it's only an hour so that they can rush back and run their stories. But countless times when a journalist is asked, well, why is this funded by industry, five people on the panel will explain that. And it'll be a good explanation. And actually you watch them, you know, why is it funded by industry? And then someone at the back says, yeah, why is it? How do you know that it was protected from industry influence? They then explain, yes. and you see the interest just goes. Maybe they were onto something, that this was corrupt, but then they listen to the explanation and they accept it. Mm-hmm. So just because, and then they report the story prominently.
Yes, because they trust it.
Because they trust
so,
it.
So the journalist has to still be the gatekeeper.
Yeah. And also, that's the only way that we know how to do it. But when I was asking some of these government scientists to do speeches and things, I just think they do, and we, you know, one thing I was slightly rude about blogs and stuff at the beginning, but there are other opportunities to speak directly to the public, and some of these issues about the process of science probably will be at science festivals, and but it's being mindful of it. It's realizing that you need to include that in your description of the way science works, that sometimes it'll be industry funded.
And in lots of ways, this is what we're going to pick up next week when we have Catherine Matheson from the British Science Association and Emily Wilson from The New Scientist talking about that much more detailed, how do you help the public understand what science is about. But we have a question waiting there, and then we have the man at the front.
Yeah, I want to ask, one of the things I know puts off scientists like me and other people I know is fear of backlash. You know, especially with like the Alfie Evans and Charlie Gard, people were getting death threats. How do you encourage scientists to want to engage with the media, and you know, if their name could end up splashed across the Daily Mail and people threaten to bomb their homes? It's
so
scary.
This is really difficult, and in the end, you know, we're not about telling people they have to do this if they're afraid. People are wrongly afraid in a lot of cases. So let me tell you, Dominic Wilkinson, is that the right, have I got the right name? One of the first people that was on the slide who spoke on Charlie Gard, he came in and did it on Alfie Evans. And in that case, quite a few people were saying to us, I'm not going to comment because this particular campaign group, there are elements that are very angry, and you saw that they tried to invade the Alderhay Hospital. And so we set him up with 10 interviews a day, every day. If any of you meet him, tell him what a hero he is. He's an absolute hero. He's brilliant. And he didn't get any death threats, and he didn't get any horrible emails, and we've monitored him. On animal research, we were recruiting people to our database to speak out on animal research when there were violent extremists who'd been in prison and come out. So to ask them to do media interviews was not trivial, and it would have been unbelievably irresponsible of us to ask them if there was a risk. But the ones that spoke out in the media were not targeted. So I think it depends. If you really want to do this and you came to me, I would sit down and I would tell you the kinds of people that get targeted and why. And those people, sometimes they'll say, right, I've done this and I've been targeted, I'm no longer going to do it. Miles, I'm sure, can talk about this from the climate perspective, from climate sceptics. But there are a lot of people who say, the particular example you gave, if you gave us a quote on Charlie Gard and it appeared in the Daily Mail, my almost near promise to you is nothing would happen. Because we've been doing this for 17 years, and that's not the way it works. It's just not the way it works. The animals thing, you know, the irony was that the way the extremists would find out who was doing animal research is they'd read the scientific papers. And then, you know, when these universities, they were building animal labs in the middle of the university, three people on campus knew. The students didn't know, the lecturers didn't know, nobody knew, except the director of comms for the university, the vice chancellor, and the extremists, who all knew. So it was ludicrous. So that's my problem with Charlie Gard and Alfie Evans, is that everybody is scared to speak. But if you think about the impact of that, then it's that thing about how you want women to walk home very late. You want all women to walk home very late at night, because if you're the only one that does it and everyone else is scared, then you feel more vulnerable. But and that's what we've got with animal research. We've got a concordat on openness on animal research, which every university has signed up to, every company, and strength in numbers. And still to this day, I'm sure you get this, Stephen, people will say, I can't speak on animals because I'll be targeted. No, you really won't. There are no extremists anymore. The police have said openness is the best strategy. So I know what you mean. And if you were scared, I wouldn't encourage you. But if you were open-minded and said, I would really like to comment on this, if I give you a written comment and it goes out, will I be vulnerable? I would say mostly. I don't know if you disagree. This is quite a serious question, so I don't want to be flippant about it. But I think in people's minds, it's over-exaggerated. And some of those death threats, they were against the medics in the hospital. They weren't against named individuals who'd given quotes. I mean, the irony is that none of them gave quotes. Not a single named individual from Alderhay, a clinician, spoke out during that. They gave official corporate comments to the court.
We just have one last question, just because of time, at the front here.
Thanks very much. I think you showed a nice slide about how scientists are still quite high up there on the rankings of trust, but certainly over the last few years, there's at least been this narrative of, you know, the British public have had enough of experts. And, you know, discussing it in the university, it's easy enough for us to say, oh, you know, stupid public or stupid journalists causing them to think that. But I wondered what your thoughts were on what we could do as scientists to stop that impression. And is it something to do with values? And is it where we stray beyond talking about the science and start bringing in our own values, which are maybe less widely shared than we might think in the general public?
Yeah, it's a lovely question because we run all kinds of briefings, as I said, and if the kind of the big wigs, you know, the scientific community wants to speak out with one voice, then we always say, well, can't, you know, if the head of the MLC, the head of Wellcome, the head of come to the SMC, we're a nice neutral venue. So with that in mind, we emailed everyone and said, Brexit's coming, you can't just sit back, you have a responsibility. So we ran three briefings and they were all these big wigs. And on reflection, they were so self-serving. You know, we will lose funding. You talk about, do the public know what, you know, the science, the process of science is? We will lose out on framework. Now, I don't even know what framework 9 is. What's the MRHA thing that was based in London? The European, I can't remember what it was called. European Medicines, yeah, EMEA, is it? So one of them was saying, you know, if this happens, the EMEA will leave London and it's got 10,000 staff there. And I said, who are the EMEA? And I'd done this job for 17 years. I've never met their press office, never heard them say anything. So it was, there were terrible arguments really and they were self-serving, and actually none of them got reported, interesting, very little reporting of them from three separate press briefings. We then had a briefing, brave souls, it was Paul Nurse, Sarah Main from CASE, and a couple of others who came in after Brexit, and it was a mourning exercise, but it was a grieving, and the journalists were very upset, the science journalists were generally Remain, and the scientific community were. And in that, Sarah said something about this whole thing about values and looking at, you know, that whole thing, what is it, Goodhart, who talks about the people who stay here and the people who are from everywhere, the people who are from here and the people who are from everywhere. And what I think the scientific community really didn't do was get over that kind of value, the value of global, you know, global science. Nobody's interested in doing science just in Oxford. They're always wanting to collaborate. They need people to come to the UK to study, to get those collaborations. They need to be able to go to China and India and Harvard. And so that whole sense, no, I'm not saying that would have changed anything, but yeah, I think there is something that's like, and that's what I like about this, that when you are sitting in a radio station in this kind of debate, you're not going to get technical questions from the Radio 5 Live presenter. You are going to get, right, translate that to me for my anti-flow. What does that mean? And then scientists do kind of talk more freely and more openly about their, you know, why they're passionate about science, what it is about the process. I'm not from science. You read out my, and I thought I've done equality issues, I've done single parents, now I'll go into science for a few years. And I've never left because I absolutely love it. And there's something about the endeavour, you know, the search for the truth, whether we achieve it or not, that drive to be objective and not just to give you my opinion. My husband is a head of politics in a school, and now I kind of spit at him and say, that is pure ideology. It's just an ideological position. And he says, ideology is good. Ideas are really good. But I know I'm sick of people spouting ideas. I want evidence. I really have got into evidence. So that kind of thing. Of course the public want evidence. Of course they do. When they're taking drugs, when they're deciding about the future of the planet, when they're looking at floods, you know, what is the solution for floods? They don't want somebody to just latch onto something and go on about dredging if it's not the solution. They want the right solution. So that was not very articulate, but I think it's the right question, and I think scientists have to think about how we present ourselves. And I'm sure, I mean, I guess universities now are really thinking about their place in their local communities and more so since Brexit. And that's a good thing. I think a period of reflection as to how we do this better is really important.
Thank you so much. Thank you for an amazing talk that took us through the sort of nuts and bolts of what you do, and then a very open and candid discussion afterwards. So can we thank Fiona for... and just to remind you that next week we will be trying to delve into how do we use, or how do organisations like The New Scientist, or the Journal of The New Scientist, and the British Science Association, how can they really encourage people to understand what science and research is all about? So that's next week, same time, same place. Thank you.